Thank you. Thank you. The reason that I created this podcast is because I want to feel better. So many of the right-wing talk show hosts that I've listened to over the years make me feel worse, more anxious, more fearful, angrier. And I want to feel better, and I want the people who listen to my podcast to feel better after having listened to it than they did at the beginning.
I was in England working and being a tourist. I love England. I'm a big history buff. The castles, the museums. You stay in shape. There's a lot of walking. You walk everywhere. We went to Windsor Castle. The bus dropped us off at the front lawn. You know how big the lawn of a castle is? The purpose of the lawn is so that when armies would invade in days of yore, they would give up before they got across the lawn. They invaded from France for hundreds of years. They never got across that lawn. They'd get halfway and go, oh, this is bullshit. I can't even see the castle from here, Henri. We've been walking 2 days. I'm going back to Calais.
Good morning. It is Tuesday, Trump Tuesday, April the 2nd, and this is The True Conservative. Welcome to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there. I'm Ron, your host, and the only true conservative in the United States today. So today, after the Serenity Prayer and the Patriotic Song of the Day, we will have the Patriotic Shorts, Motivation, Bishop Barron, Ayn Rand, the 33 Strategies of War, and Donald Trump. All that and more when I get back. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I should not change, the courage to change the things I should, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Thank you, thank you. Now a little bit of police radio.
Shortcut 95. Right, there's a crash here. It says Cermak in Albany, out in front of the Chase Bank. Two cars. There's no injury, so maybe they can go in. I got no vehicle description, though.
1420.
42 asks that you look at your computer or stop by the suspicious object. 2917 West Chicken. It's a bad phone. They're processing.
Four, man. It's not many. It's only like about eight. They're inside the, culinary building on 63rd Street. So they're still forming. It's supposed to end around one.
At 4108 Sacramento, maybe a traffic crash. We'll let you know in a second.
All right, 10-4.
4 squad, PPO, be a good learning experience for.
Believe she's bipolar. She's recently broken up with her boyfriend and may also be pregnant. So he's requesting to check the well-being. I'm Kayla Cook, age 23, female, brown shoulder-length hair. She's about 190, or I'm correction, about 90 to 100 pounds. 2447 Flournoy on the 3.
Okay, where is your email?
072920-7292.
10-4, thank you. We're clear.
Yes, 10-4.
Any covert assets near Balboa, Michigan? Do we have any command posts?
That CSA that's in here, it's a male.
4 shirt, blue shorts. He's approaching, it looks like, gate 3. He's got a camera on a stick, and he's filming all of the police vehicles and all the entrances in that. I'm going to follow him until I get a covert asset over here.
Okay. Balbo in Michigan, we got a suspicious guy, male, white, backpack, blue flowered shirt, blue shorts, with a camera and a stick. He's filming all of the police vehicles in that area. 3700 has eyes on him.
Looks like they're calling on each other.
There for now. Yes. Can you check for a suspicious person for me? 4879 on Mason, 4879 North Mason. Okay, so far. Wednesday, today.
Who's coming in?
1623.
623, go ahead.
What are those names? Yeah, I can't have a lot of them.
Alarm at Echo Development, 2721 West Haddon.
Lawrence and Pulaski, Citizen states that got a male Hispanic lots of tattoos on a faceplate eastbound by the Starbucks behind a Walgreens. No further information. 17 District 01. Station's clear.
He's got brown hair, two-tone blue backpack, a blue flowered shirt, blue shorts. He's got a camera on a stick. He's now going eastbound into the garden area. He's filming all the police vehicles, the garden area, as well as the bridge area.
Trespassing progress, 3233 West 61st, 3233 West 61 in the rear, Joanna. On her camera, she sees two unknown male Hispanics in her backyard.
In Pulaski, so it should be the caller inside that location.
Sure.
10-4, thank you, and then we're on our way to medical.
Towards the 8th Street Bridge now.
John
525-5206-4642.
Okay, 10-4 copy. 1106 David. 29 is responding. Let me see for what.
And that was a little bit of first responder radio. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, the patriotic shorts.
When I was an instructor in Ranger School, all the other instructors had been to Vietnam. I had not. And just my conscience wouldn't let me live with that. So I volunteered to go to Vietnam. I was fortunate enough to be selected to be an advisor, so I went a year to language school and was assigned to the 22nd Ranger Group, Vietnamese Ranger Group, in Vietnam. And with a year of language school, I was widely received. And my Vietnamese group commander, Colonel Sam, had gone through American Ranger School. And he remembered me from the mountaineering committee. And so it was just an immediate bond. And my first tour in Vietnam was an enjoyable tour, 99.9%. But I truly enjoyed it. I worked with some seriously professional Vietnamese.
Why, there's a strange-looking vehicle on the flight deck of this U.S. Navy ship is not what you think. In 2019, Iranian drones near USS Boxer were taken down, but not with missiles or guns. It was this guy. See those drums at the top? These are part of a system that detects and shoots down small drones and low-flying aircraft with the help of 360-degree radars, electronic warfare suites, and other sensors. Simply put, it fries the electronics inside drones and takes them down. And since drones are often too small in size and too large in numbers to be detected and hunted by existing air defense systems, U.S. Marines take this vehicle with them wherever they go.
That first one, man, it was a helo op. We just did the brief. We hopped on the birds, did the rehearsals like we always do, and then hopped on the bird and went to target. We do the, you know, 1 minute out. Everybody's getting gear ready. I got the night vision on. I'm looking around the helicopter, seeing the TLs, what they're doing, my TL, and I'm basically just going to be on his hip and hauling to the breach point. So we were in Blackhawks and the doors are off, and I'm peeking my head over the side and I see like gunfire coming up and dudes are shooting. We land, we immediately go to cover. I mean, we're taking fire and I go hide behind the smallest little berm. I mean, we're all engaging and comms start coming up and we're starting to move. I get a tap on the shoulder. I was like, what are you doing? It's like, I'm taking cover. And he's like John Wayne gun hanging. He's like, dude, let's go. Just calm as can be. And I'm like literally cowering my whole 180 body behind this thing. Blinders came off and I was like, oh, okay. It was like all around me but not towards us. He's walking, he looks at me and I can see the nods. He's just like such disgust and disappointment, isn't
it? MS Duncan is escorting a British tanker through the Strait of Hormuz. It's an Iranian gunboat that is heading in their direction. Crew decides to issue a warning. The Iranians respond immediately.
You are ordered to keep well clear of this area. Over.
He's going to try and cross the bow of the tanker.
The Iranian ship makes a direct turn towards the British tanker.
You are closing my position. Your intentions are unclear. If you close within 500 yards, I will illuminate you with a flare. Over.
But as the Iranian gunboat retreats, it sends through one final message.
Irritation. I cannot read you because the English is very poor.
This map was kept hidden by the British government for over 100 years. The reason was simple. It reveals that the British may have been willing to give up way more land to the United States after the Revolutionary War, but the United States didn't ask for it. Spain was fighting the British alongside the U.S., and they wanted to keep fighting until they took back Gibraltar. But the Spanish said they would stop if they could be given most of what was west of the Appalachian Mountains. The British saw this as an opportunity to break the U.S. away from their new French and Spanish allies, and they were willing to give up large portions of Canada to do so. The U.S. delegation just didn't realize how much they were willing to give. Richard Oswald of the British delegation at the 1783 Treaty of Paris drew the red lines on this map for the private use of his colleagues, but after the United States asked for less, the map was put away and access restricted until 1896.
When Westmoreland became commanding general, I think he started at I Corps and then he became the big muckety muck of the whole Vietnam War. And his first order to us was no loaded weapons on the bunker line. You had to have a clear chamber, and you could have the clip sitting next to you. But if you saw movement, you had to call the officer of the day. You had to wait for him to come down, see what you saw. And you couldn't fire off a flare. He had to do that. So he had to confirm that you saw what you saw, and then he would make a decision. And believe me, he felt the same way we did, because he had better know what he was getting into to say open fire or to hold back. Later on, it didn't matter to me. I loaded my weapon anyway.
Everybody on the show always gets a gift, and usually it's a bag of Vigilance Elite gummy bears from my company. But for you, I wanted to give you this rosary.
Oh.
And
I want to tell you about
that rosary. When I found my faith, I got public about it. And a good friend of mine, his name's Dom Razzo. We were together at SEAL Team 2, and then he went on to development group SEAL Team 6. And when he saw that I'd come out and announced my faith, he sent me that rosary to give me protection, and I've carried it with me every day since.
My goodness.
With the stuff that you're about to uncover with this new film,
yeah.
Sounds of Freedom, I think maybe you're going to need some of that protection. So it's my honor to pass that on to you.
Thank you very much.
When a float plane from New Jersey spotted the fleeing destroyer over the horizon, New Jersey and Iowa pursued at more than 30 knots, opening fire straight ahead at extreme ranges. New Jersey straddled Milwaukee several times, including at a range of 35,700 yards. New Jersey's last salvo, fired from the impressive range of 22 miles, is believed to be the longest range gunshot at an enemy ship in history.
Hold on a moment. I'll take this part. For our viewers familiar with the Delaware Valley, imagine New Jersey, from its current location in Camden, firing over the city of Philadelphia and purposely dropping a salvo of 16-inch shells into the northern end of Sweetbriar Park in King of Prussia, Pennsylvania. But on this day, both ships were moving at more than 30 knots.
And that was the Patriotic Shorts. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, a little motivation.
In order to develop and to change and to grow, stress is necessary. So you got to be willing to go get it every day. There's a story my father told me all the time. He said every morning on the plains of the eastern Serengeti Desert, there arises a gazelle that realizes that he must run faster than the fastest lion, or he will be eaten and he will die that day. On that same desert arises in the morning a lion that realizes that he must run faster than the fastest gazelle, or he will starve and he will die that day. He says, son, the moral of the story is, no matter who you is, when you wake up in the morning, you need to be running. And so what he taught me was a work ethic of how to work. In order to get to where you want to go, you got to put yourself under some stress, though. See, stress is necessary. See, but a seed has to be planted. A seed got to have dirt put on top of it. But guess what? Logically, in my mind, it doesn't make sense that to grow something, you should dig a hole, put it down in there, and cover it with dirt. Logically, that don't make no sense to me. But oh, though. See, dirt is necessary for growth and development. Dirt builds character. Dirt gives you the push-through factor. Dirt makes you come with it when you don't feel like coming with it no more. And you get dirt in a lot of different ways. All of y'all that had dirt thought, bestowed on you. And dirt ain't always what you want. It's somebody talking about you down on your job. It's somebody accusing you of something that you didn't do. It's somebody telling you you ain't gonna make it. It's somebody sharing information about you that ain't true. Everybody get dirt put on. But see, when you getting put under that stress, see, that dirt builds character in you. When they talking about you, it teaches you to withstand it. Then it gives you something to push through. So when you put the seed and you put the dirt on it, if you understand stress, stress really ain't just dirt. See, they don't call it dirt when they plant it. They call it soil. Because, see, soil has nutrients in it. So when people talking about you, dogging you, lying on you, stealing from you, talking about you, they're actually putting nutrients in you. They're building character. You got character now. And now the seed, if they put a camera under the ground, you'd have seen the seed sprout open and start coming through the dirt. Because the dirt is necessary so you can prove yourself. Everything you see above ground that blossoms and plants and grows and that's beautiful, it was underground one time. All them potatoes, collard greens, they was underground one time. Them apple trees, they was underground one time. So they had to prove themselves. See, you want to be successful, well, then you got to prove yourself. You got to push through the dirt. You got to come up through here. You got to come out. Then you sprout, and then bishops say, then you become a tree. Next thing you know, you got fruit. So when you under stress, take the stress for what it is. Don't get fooled. Don't just think, oh, man, Lord must not mean for it to be. What you tripping for? What you talking about? How you think you're going to be a plant, a tree, and ain't no stress? How you going to get to be that without no dirt? See, I expect dirt now. I expect people to talk about me. Matter of fact, I look forward to it now. Do your thing, because if I can weather what happened to me and my family earlier, you can bring whatever you got now. There's some more stuff going around now that's about to happen. Bring it. Because now I have developed a character that is stress.
Ask him, at what point do you become stronger than your strongest excuse? Meaning, even when it's valid, you can use it, and it's probably wrong that it happened, but at what point do you become stronger than your strongest excuse? Because at a certain point, life is going to place everybody in a position to where you never know how strong you are until being strong is the only choice you have.
The fruit of everything good in life begins with a challenge. Everything is a pill that's worth buying. And it's not going to come to you, and it's not going to fall in your lap, and it's not going to be something that, oh my God, it just was so simple. It's always going to be difficult.
It's easier to go from failure to success than it is from excuses to success. The moment you make excuses for your life, you take the exit off of where you're trying to go. Because excuses give you a reason for not being exceptional. It gives you a reason for not showing up. It gives you a reason for not delivering the goods. It gives you a reason for not being the person that you wanted to be. Remember this, excuses always shrink your stature. Excuses are the quicksand in the land of the living. And the moment that you begin to excuse yourself and make it a lifestyle, you never can be a person of excellence and you can never be a person of success.
Excuses sound best to the person that's making them up. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Get off the pity party. Telling everybody your sad and sob stories, trying to get people to show up to your pity parties and your pity parades. If you ever see me in a Rolls Royce, a 6 or 7 star hotel, living my life to the fullest, don't get jealous of me. Because I worked my ass off to get it. Nobody handed me nothing.
The chronic excuse maker. How do you stop making excuses? This is actually pretty simple. And I said it the other day, and you have to realize, you have to know, you have to accept that all your excuses are lies. They are lies, all of them. Think about the things that you tell yourself, the lies you use to rationalize taking the easy road. Taking the easy road and leaving discipline behind. Think about them. You don't have time. That's a lie. You don't have support. That's a lie. You don't have the equipment or the gear. Lies. You don't know the best way. Who cares? That's a lie. Or you're too old or you're too young. Of course, you're too old or too young. Lie. And there's you're too busy. Sure you are. And the list goes on and on and on. And it doesn't stop if you don't make it stop. So recognize the excuses are not valid. They're trumped up. They're conjured up. They're fabricated. They're lies.
What's stopping you? Are you too tired? Didn't get enough sleep? Don't have enough energy? Don't have enough time? Is that what's stopping you right now? Don't have enough money? Is that the thing? Or is the thing that's stopping you, you?
Courage is not the absence of fear. It is moving forward in spite of it. I have to have the courage. And let me tell you something. Most Americans don't have this kind of courage. I have to have the courage to stop making excuses. Is this going to be the year you stop making excuses? Do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? Do you want your life to change? Do you want your finances to be different? Do you want your marriage to be different? Do you want to cure cancer? I can't. I'm too old. I'm too young. I'm too fat. I'm too thin. I can't. Right?
And that was a little bit of motivation. Thank you, thank you. And now, the daily law for April the 2nd.
April 2nd. Make the master feel glorious and superior. Like all Renaissance scientists, Galileo depended on the generosity of great rulers to support his research. No matter how great the discovery, however, his patrons usually paid him with gifts, not cash. This made for a life of constant insecurity and dependence. In 1610, he hit on a new strategy when he discovered the moons of Jupiter. Galileo turned his discovery into a cosmic event honoring the Medici's greatness. The Medici's made Galileo their official court philosopher and mathematician, with a full salary. Scientists are not spared the vagaries of court life and patronage. They too must serve masters who hold the purse strings. And their great intellectual powers can make the master feel insecure, as if he were only there to supply the funds, an ugly, ignoble job. The producer of a great work wants to feel he is more than just the provider of the financing. He wants to appear creative and powerful, and also more important than the work produced in his name. Instead of insecurity, you must give him glory. Galileo did not challenge the intellectual authority of the Medicis with his discovery or make them feel inferior in any way. By literally aligning them with the stars, he made them shine brilliantly among the courts of Italy. He did not outshine the master. He made the master outshine all others. Daily law. Not only don't outshine the master, but make those above you shine brilliantly. The 48 Laws of Power, Law 1, Never Outshine the Master.
And that was the Daily Law for April the 2nd from the book, The Daily Laws by Robert Greene. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, Bishop Robert Barron.
You're not just dumbly here or a result of a cosmic accident. No, you've been willed into existence by God. Why did he create you? Because he's got a mission for you. Hey, it might not be what the world thinks is important. Who cares? What's your mission from God? Might be the quietest thing. It's little in the eyes of the world, but great in the eyes of God. Now, here's the point. Once you understand what that is, move. Act. Don't procrastinate. Don't fall asleep. Go in haste. Don't waste time. Life is short, and the mission is clear. Be about the work the Lord has given you to do.
And that was Bishop Robert Barron. Back in a minute. Thank you. And now the Ayn Rand thought of the day. Quote, racism is the lowest, most crudely primitive form of collectivism. It is the notion of ascribing moral, social, or political significance to a man's genetic lineage. The notion that a man's intellectual and characterological traits are produced and transmitted by his internal body chemistry. Which means, in practice, that a man is to be judged not by his own character and actions, but by the characters and actions of a collective of ancestors. Unquote. And that was the Ayn Rand thought of the day. Back in a minute. Thank you. And now we pick up where we left off with the 33 strategies of war.
It would be helpful to know beforehand which kind of negotiator you face. The difficulty is that skillful warriors will make themselves masters of disguise. At first, they will seem sincere and friendly, then will reveal their warrior nature when it is too late. In resolving a conflict with an enemy you do not know well, it is always best to protect yourself by playing the warrior yourself. Negotiate while advancing. There will always be time to back off and fix things if you go too far. But if you fall prey to a warrior, you will be unable to recoup anything. In a world in which there are more and more warriors, you must be willing to wield the sword as well, even if you are a shopkeeper at heart. Reversal. In negotiation, as in war, you must not let yourself get carried away. There is a danger in advancing too far, talking too much, to the point where you create an embittered enemy who will work for revenge. So it was after World War I with the Allies, who imposed such harsh conditions on Germany in negotiating the peace that they arguably laid the foundations for World War II. A century earlier, on the other hand, when Metternich negotiated, it was always his goal to prevent the other side from feeling wronged. Your purpose in any settlement you negotiate is never to satisfy greed or to punish the other side, but to secure your own interests. In the long run, a punitive settlement will only win you insecurity. Here are further reflections on the diplomatic war strategy. From A World Restored by Henry Kissinger. Lord Aberdeen, the British ambassador to Austria, proved even easier to deal with. Only 29 years old, barely able to speak French, he was not a match for a diplomat of Metternich's subtlety. His stiffness and self-confidence only played into Metternich's hands. "Metternich is extremely attentive to Lord Aberdeen," reported Cathcart. The results were not long delayed. Metternich had once described the diplomat's task as the art of seeming a dupe without being one, and he practiced it to the fullest on the high-minded Aberdeen. "Do not think Metternich such a formidable personage," Aberdeen wrote to Castlereagh. "Living with him at all times, is it possible I should not know him? If indeed he were the most subtle of mankind, he might certainly impose on one little used to deceive, but this is not his character. He is, I repeat it to you, not a very clever man. He is vain, but he is to be trusted." For his mixture of condescension and gullibility, Aberdeen earned himself Metternich's sarcastic epithet as the dear simpleton of diplomacy. From The Greek Myths by Robert Graves. In gratitude for his acquittal, Orestes dedicated an altar to warlike Athena. But the Erinyes threatened, if the judgments were not reversed, to let fall a drop of their own heart's blood, which would bring barrenness upon the soil, blight the crops, and destroy all the offspring of Athens. Athena nevertheless soothed their anger by flattery. Acknowledging them to be far wiser than herself, she suggested that they should take up residence in a grotto at Athens, where they would gather such throngs of worshippers as they could never hope to find elsewhere. Hearth altars proper to underworld deities should be theirs, as well as sober sacrifices, torchlight libations, first fruits offered after the consummation of marriage or the birth of children, and even seats in the Erechtheum. If they accepted this invitation, she would decree that no house where worship was withheld from them might prosper. But they, in return, must undertake to invoke fair winds for her ships, fertility for her land, and fruitful marriages for her people. Also rooting out the impious, so that she might see fit to grant Athens victory in war. The Erinyes, after a short deliberation, graciously agreed to these proposals.
And that was the end of chapter 21, Negotiate While Advancing, from the 33 Strategies of War by Robert Greene. Back in a minute. Thank you. If you're a Democrat, you should be voting Republican. And if you're a Democrat, woman, because we are the party of women. We're the party of strong women. We know that abortion does not empower women. As a matter of fact, it empowers men. Men are the beneficiaries of abortions, not women. So remember, you're a Democrat woman, you need to vote Republican. Back in a minute. Thank you. Now a little bit of Bill O'Reilly.
These other progressive things. We got to stop this now. I'm telling you, I don't have any progressive friends anymore. They're gone because I can't stomach them. Criminals running wild, murdering people because progressive DAs funded by George Soros don't want to punish the violent criminals. That's what you're giving me. You support that? Get out of my house. Out. I've had it. Biden is not going to get any better. And the Democratic Party has to get destroyed next November. I don't care whether you like Trump or not. Trump governed this nation in a responsible way where everybody prospered. And if you don't believe that, you're a moron. Every single thing, every single indicator was on positive territory. All the working people, no matter what color they were making more money and there were more jobs. We didn't have inflation. We didn't have supply problems. We didn't have any of it. Now we got all of it, in addition to an open border. These other
He's right. This is the reason I'm playing this is because it's about time somebody said this. And it's about time he said this. He's been riding the gravy train for a long time. He's been this neutral observer and using the events of the day to write books and get rich. Now, finally, it dawns on him that if he doesn't do something, he doesn't stand up culturally, not just politically, but culturally, stand up and do something, there's not going to be any riches for him to take advantage of. Okay, and when I mean stand up culturally, he said all of his left-wing buddies and friends, all of his socialist, Democrat friends are gone. He kicked them out. Get out of the house. We all need to do that. Now, I've already done that myself. I figured that out a long time ago. I don't want to associate with people that are going to be backing idiots like President Joe Biden. I'm just not going to do it. Okay, so if that's the way you want to go, you go your way, I'll go mine. But especially stay out of my house. And I've said it before. If you have a neighbor that's like that, if you have a neighbor that, for instance, decides that they're going to trans their kid and butcher them up and put them on all kinds of medications, I'm not going to have anything to do with him. I'm going to just walk past him. I might even tell him, look, you're a scumbag and I don't want anything to do with you. As far as I'm concerned, the only reason you're not in prison is because this isn't illegal yet. But I'm looking forward to the day that what you're doing is illegal and you go to prison. And then after that, I don't even acknowledge him. He doesn't exist. Again, be conservative, live conservative, surround yourself with conservatives. That's how we win, culturally speaking. Politically, a little bit of a different story, but culturally speaking, that's the way we win. And that's what Bill O'Reilly is finally woken up to. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. And now, Donald Trump.
Do you guys want to be successful or don't you care? Okay, you better believe it. Sometimes in life, to be successful, oftentimes, most of the time, you have to follow your instincts. You have to follow your gut. You have to. In life, in order to be successful, and you people are well on the road to success, you have to find out what makes you excited. What makes you want to get up each morning and go to work. You have to find it. I was no different when I was 20 years old, believe me. I wanted to be successful. I wanted to get out of Brooklyn. I said, Pop, I love you, but I want to get out of Brooklyn. I love Brooklyn, but I want to get out. And I'd see those big buildings, those big skyscrapers in Manhattan. I said, Pop, that's what I want to do. That's what I wanted to do. I love taking things and fixing them. Taking things and building. I love building.
You can do anything. You can be anything you want to be. But in order to succeed, you must find out what you love to do. You have to find your passion, no matter what they tell you. They said, there is no path to victory for Donald Trump. They forgot about the forgotten people. By the way, they're not forgetting about the forgotten people anymore. They're going crazy trying to figure it out. But I told them, far too late. It's far too late.
You have to have an ability to handle pressure. Because you, no matter how successful you are, I have many, many friends and enemies, a lot of enemies too, I don't care. And people that can handle pressure can be entrepreneurs, can be successful. Now, I have some friends that are really, really smart, but they can't handle pressure. In which case, they should work for somebody, do great, and have a good life. There's nothing wrong with it. And if you can't handle pressure, you have to know that about yourself. You have to know that about yourself. So, handle pressure. If you can't, that's okay. Some people, they say, I've got to be successful. I've got to be. They'll never be successful. It's too crazy. They can't think straight. You have to remember, it doesn't matter. God matters. Your family matters. You've got to be able to sort of say to yourself, nothing matters that much other than the real big deals.
I used to love going to Sunday school. People don't know this about Trump. They think, oh, Trump, you know, Trump. But the truth is, I went to Sunday school. And I loved going to Sunday school. And I did for years. And I learned a lot. And I learned about God. And that was probably the greatest thing I've ever learned. Forget all the business stuff. Never cease to be proud of who you are and the principles you hold dear and stand by. Wear your values as your badge of honor. Go out. Have a great time in life. Compete. Remember your duty. Honor your history. Take care of the people God put into your life. And if you refuse to give in to doubt or to fear, and you will win, 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 and help people in doing so. If you love what you do and dedicate yourself to your work, then you will gain momentum. And look, you have to.
You need the word momentum. You will gain that momentum. And each success will create another success. I'll tell you a story that's very interesting for me. When I was young, there was a man named William Levitt. And he was a very successful man. And he built homes. And at night, he'd go to these major sites with teams of people. And he'd scour the sites for nails and sawdust. And they'd clean the sites so when the workers came in the next morning, the sites would be spotless and clean. And he did it properly. And he did this for 20 years. And then he was offered a lot of money for his company. And he sold his company for a tremendous amount of money. And he went out and bought a big yacht. And the company that bought his company was a big conglomerate. And they didn't know anything about building homes. And they didn't know anything about picking up the nails and the sawdust and selling it and the scraps of wood. This was a big conglomerate based in New York City. And after about a 10-year period, they were losing a lot with it. So they called William Levitt up. And they said, would you like to buy back your company? And he said, yes, I would. He so badly wanted. He got bored with this life of yachts and sailing and all of the things he did in the south of France and other places. He bought back his company. And he bought back a lot of empty land. And he worked hard on getting it zoning. And he worked hard on starting to develop. And in the end, he failed. And he failed badly. He lost all of his money. He went personally bankrupt. And I saw him at a cocktail party. And it was very sad because the hottest people in New York were at this party. And I see sitting in the corner was a little old man who was all by himself. Nobody was talking to him. I immediately recognized that that man was the once great William Levitt of Levittown. And he explained what was happening and how bad it's been and how hard it's been. And I said, what exactly happened? Why did this happen to you? And he said, Donald, I lost my momentum. A word you never hear when you're talking about success, when some of these guys that never made 10 cents, they're on television giving you things about how you're going to be successful. And the only thing they ever did was a book and a tape. It was very sad, and I never forgot that moment. And I thought about it, and it's exactly true. He lost his momentum. In life, I always tell this to people, you have to know whether or not you continue to have the momentum. And if you don't have it, that's okay. Because you're going to go on, and you're going to learn, and you're going to do things that are great. But you have to know about the word momentum.
Always have passion. You've got to have passion for your family, for your life, for your church, for whatever it is. You've got to have that passion. You've got to just love it. I would always say to people, and I'd see people, and I'd say, you got to love what you do. Because, you know, if you love what you do, you work harder. And I've seen so many instances where people with great talent went into things that they didn't love. And they failed. I've seen people that are super genius, but they don't have that gut feeling. They don't have that stick-to-itiveness, that never quit. And I've seen people that almost made it and failed because they couldn't go that extra mile.
But when you do something that you love, you'll never fail. What you're going to do is give it a shot again and again. And again, you're ultimately going to be successful. And remember this, you're not working. When you do something that you love, remember this, it's not work. So you'll work 24/7, you're gonna work all the time. And at the end of a year, you're not really working. You don't think of it as work. When you're not doing something that you like, that's called work. And it's hard work and tedious work. So as much as you can, do something that you love. Work hard and never, ever give up, and you're going to be tremendously successful. Tremendously successful. Work hard, get in the game, play to win, and most of all, have a good time, have fun. Your lives will have meaning and purpose and joy. You will become leaders,
and you will inspire others to achieve the dreams they once thought were totally impossible. Things that you said could never, ever happen are already happening for you. When natural disaster strikes, when people face hardship, you learn the rewards of hard work and perseverance. Never, ever give up. Never quit. Persevere. Never, ever quit. You learn to contribute to your communities, to take pride in your nation, and to seek out opportunities to serve. You also learn to believe in yourself, so important, to have confidence in your ability, and to take responsibility for your own life.
And that was Donald Trump. Back in a minute. Thank you, thank you. This is Ron, your host, the only true conservative in the United States today, bidding adios to all the butchers, bakers, and candlestick makers out there and reminding you that you are not neutral and that the government has no rights.